get overwhelmed with it sometimes. Joyce has been a good friend for a lot of years, but more than that, she's been a good teacher, a good mentor, and many, many other things. She and her friend started a ministry called Victory Fellowship Assemblies International, and they gather pastors from around the world to work ecumenically together. And I don't know how many countries you got pastors in now, but we're part of that as part of the Odyssey Church. We're a small, small part of it.
No,
I keep saying,
four.
Well, where we are, because I keep saying I'm going to go down and have a meeting every year in July, and I'm praying this year I can get down there. Last year, surgery kept me from going. The year before that, we just planted the church, and that kept me from going. I'm hoping that God sees it fit that I be down there this year. I get the reports back, and what takes place is wonderful. And it's good to meet people from all around, not just the country, but around the world. It's an international ministry. So I just want to thank you for allowing us to be part of that. Stephen was here last year playing, but this year we get to hear him speak. So with that, I'm going to ask it that we bow and we pray and we ask God to take over this service.
Yes.
Lord, you tell us that even in small groups where we gather together, Lord, that you're here present. Father, we thank you so much for that. We thank you that by the power of your Holy Spirit that we can do what's not possible in our own humanness, Lord. And one of the things, Lord, as I read and I study the scriptures, the greatest miracle that we forget about, that, Lord, we want to see people healed of cancer. We want to see people that be resurrected from dead. We want all these great manifestations, Lord. But as I read the scriptures, the greatest miracle of all is salvation. So I thank you, Lord, that you allow this church to be used for your glory, Lord, that we've seen people come and give their life over to you. Father, as this service takes place today, Lord, I ask that you touch each one of our hearts, that you use Joyce and Stephen, Lord, whether it's through music or the spoken word, just use them for your glory today. Let them impact each one of us in a way that draws us closer to you. Lord, this service is about you. Let us not forget that. You use instruments like Joyce and Stephen, but we're here to glorify you. We're here to worship the living God. Father, we thank you and praise you. And Lord, we look forward to what you're going to do even today. In the name of Jesus Christ, amen.
Amen.
Let's stand and let's sing together. And I'm going to go back here and try to work this computer, but you know how I am. Well, we're going to go ahead and take our morning offering, and I want to let you know that there's going to be two offerings today. The first offering is for the church. The second offering is for Joyce Igo. And truly, if you have to make a decision, which one, give it to Joyce. I'm so thankful we had our Strive for Five campaign, and we really exceeded every expectation. And I'm very thankful for those of you in the church that really stepped up to the plate. We said Strive for Five, seven would be heaven, eight would be great, and we went a little bit over $8,000.
Oh,
so praise God, I thank you for what he did for us. And a lot of that had to do with, in fact, the majority of that had to do with the people right here. And I just thank you so very, very much. It allowed us to go into 2017 with everything paid, everything caught up today. And I'm very, very thankful. So Heavenly Father, we praise you. We thank you today for what you're doing. I thank you for Joyce Igo and Stephen to come here from West Virginia, Lord, to minister to us. And Lord, I just pray today that you'll speak wisdom, that you'll speak, your spirit will speak through them. That, Lord, that you'll hide them behind your cross, Lord, and that you will allow your Son, the Christ, the Messiah, the anointed of God, Jesus, to be exemplified and exalted above all others. Father, we praise you and thank you, Lord. We ask that as we go into 2017, that you just multiply what we do here. Multiply our finances, multiply our effort, multiply our congregation, Lord. Not anything for our glory, but all for your glory. And Father, we just pray that many come to salvation, that many come to know you, that 2017 will be a year of revival in the Selbyville area and the Selbyville community, and that you allow us to be a catalyst and to be part of. But we know it can't be done without your Spirit. So Lord, we praise you and we thank you in the precious name of our Savior, Jesus the Christ. Amen. Amen. And now I'm turning everything over to Joyce, and God bless you all.
Well, when Paul met the Lord on the Damascus Road, he never was the same again. When Peter met the Lord, he left his boat and started fishing for men. Well, I may not be Peter or Paul, but one thing I can truly say, when I met the Lord and made him my choice, he definitely made a change.
do the acapella one.
Which one?
I know.
You do two of them now.
I know, that's true. I know that. He usually asks me what it is I know. Sometimes that's nothing. Especially when I have to get up at 5 o'clock in the morning. Oh, my goodness.
We're both a little out of it this morning.
I'm just not a morning person. I think that's my problem. Yeah, but it's okay. We're happy to be with you all today.
Welcome to the group.
We're glad to be with the fellow believers, the disciples of Jesus Christ.
Even if we did have to get up at 5 o'clock.
And even if there is a small
amount. Oh,
sister, I have been to a church where I preached only three. And one of them was my mother. So it's fine. It's
well,
okay.
She needed it the worst, probably. Okay.
It's a
don't tell her I said that, though.
She probably already again. She probably already knows you've said it.
Probably. We listen to this song on, what is it we listen to it on? MP3 player.
She has a bunch of songs on her iPhone, and I figured out how to get it to play through the stereo system of the car, through the Bluetooth thingamajigger. And we just driving along the road listening to all kinds of songs, and we found this song, and it was really nice. It was by the Kingsmen, who I really like, and it had really good words, nice rhythm, I guess is what she says, but it didn't rhyme. And so every time it came on, it's like, oh, it's such a good song, and then they get to that second line, it's like, oh my gosh.
Yeah, I have to, if it's in rhyme, I can't remember it.
No, we didn't do that. No, mm-hmm. We kept it the way it was.
Anyhow, I decided to do an acapella a bunch to his disgust. Because if he gets it too high or too low, it's his fault.
She's been known to stop me mid-song. Mm-hmm. It's like, nope, no, right, start over.
Okay, you're going to get it closer to my heart.
I was just an old beggar in sin, 'cause I wandered so far, far away from the fold. But an old-fashioned preacher told me about Jesus, and now I belong to him. I know.
I know,
yes, I This mark the Lord gave me. I know I'm a child of the King. No power can erase it. This mark the Lord gave me. I know I'm a child.
Because we need to know that we know that we know that we know Jesus Christ. And that's important. Let's do somehow.
All right.
We can remember.
See the waters raging at my feet. I can feel the breath of those surrounding me. I can hear the sound of nations rising up. We will not be overtaken. We will not be overcome. I can walk down this dark and painful road. Every fear of the unknown.
that Stephen and I've been doing together. I know the pastor has told you, I've had quite a year in 2016. I was very happy to see 2017 come off. I got to do one mission trip out of the four I had scheduled. And I did get to go to Peru for the first time. It was an awesome trip. We had a three-day ladies retreat. And I was able to pray with all kinds of ladies over all kinds of different issues that they had. And some of them had walked to get there out of the jungles. It had taken them a week to get there. It was going to take them another week to get home. But they came. It's rather disgusting to me in some ways that you come back to the States and you see people that can't even get across the road to a church on Sunday. And I don't give a thing about walking out of the jungle for a week to get there. But these people are dedicated. One little lady, she was such a blessing to me. Her feet looked like she'd never had a pair of shoes on. Her toes were twisted. And somebody gave her a pair of flip-flops and she thought she had a million-dollar pair of shoes. And I like to be able to bless the people in these countries when I go. I like to be able to bless the missionaries. I won't go if I can't bless the missionaries. They're on a shoestring budget as it is. But one of the pastor's wives down there needed teeth in the worst way. And her husband was in a position of leadership. And so I raised the money when we got back to send the money down for her to have a set of teeth. Now that may not, it was only $300. I'm sure teeth cost a whole lot more here than they do down there. But $300 when you don't have it. $1 when you don't have it is money. So, but God has been good to let me be able to help from time to time on stuff like that. Because to me, that's part of being His hands and feet. But at any rate, unfortunately, we saw some people saved down there. But unfortunately, I brought something back that I didn't need. I thought at first was just a springtime allergy because I was in the South and everything was coming out. And every year I go through throwing contact lenses out in the trash because I rubbed my eye from all the allergies and they. So that's what I thought it was, and I went out and bought Benadryl, and it wasn't doing a thing. And then I started going into like migraine headaches, which I'd had in years past that God had touched, and I thought, oh dear, now we're going into migraine. So I ran out and bought Excedrin migraine, which didn't do anything either. By the time I got to the doctor, you couldn't even tell I had an eye there. It was totally white. We got to a urgent care in Mississippi, and they wouldn't touch me. They sent me immediately to an eye specialist. And I thought he was going to pull his hair out. He was so upset that I told him this. And he said, you have no idea how bad this is. And he said, I don't even want to think about the kind of pain you're in. But that time, it felt like somebody was sticking needles in my eye 24/7. I have never been in such an excruciating pain. And so then I couldn't get home. Stephen had his car because he had filled some appointments on his own. And I had to call him, and she flew down to Birmingham, Alabama, and drove me home and got me in with a doctor there in Charleston, West Virginia. And I was off the road. They put me on breakthrough cancer patient medicine for the breakthrough pain to get the pain stopped. And that was the first time I was out of pain in a month. And I was thankful. I think I would have taken anything anybody gave me. They told me it was going to get me out of that pain. It was so bad. When they got the infection cleared up, they discovered that the infection had eaten a hole in the cornea. And so they said, I have to have a cornea transplant. Now, I am very thankful that people are willing to leave their whatever to people that will help them. But there was just something about having some dead person's cornea that did not set well with me. So Stephen thought he was helpful.
I did help.
Yeah, you thought you did.
I told her, look at it this way, Mom. Well, the Bible says that the dead in Christ will rise first. Your cornea is gone before you do.
I didn't find that helpful, Steve.
It helped me.
Yeah, true. Well, bless his heart, he did put up with a lot, man. He's had to be mad at my heart all year. Well, we got through the surgery on that. I'm off the road for Mother's Day. I told Linda Stephen, the only thing I want for Mother's Day is you take me to Thurmont, Maryland, so I can do my service there that I do every year on Mother's Day. So, thank you. And I think I was, other than that day, I was off about 3 weeks. They did the cornea transplant, and I had a booking up in upstate New York, up way up next to Quebec almost, and they had, I was playing the music for them, and they, I had to get somebody to take me because I just had a cornea transplant, and it was a 12-hour trip, and I was determined I was going if I had to go by myself. And so I talked a friend into going. Anyhow, I don't know, May and June were rough. I just, when I did go, I might fill two bookings and then I'd have to stay home. I was just so weak. And I mean, it had really been a lot. And July and August got a lot better. I was doing really well. I was starting to get some vision back. Everything was looking good. And they were telling me I was probably going to see better out of that eye than I had ever seen out of it because it was my bad eye to start with. And in September, they informed me earlier that I had a large cataract on it and they would have to take it off as soon as the cornea transplant healed up. And they told me that piece of cake, nothing to a cataract surgery. They got, when I came back around, when they woke me up, she informed me that the cataract had blown up. It had ruptured into a million pieces. I said, you people told me this was simple. Well, normally it is. You just happen to fall in the 2% of this one. And so it was a Friday. Unless it's an emergency, I'll never have surgery on Friday again. The doctor on the call that weekend, I had to pray over being mad. He did nothing. And I was in pain again. I was in a terrible shape. And my eye was all swelled out like this, and it was awful looking. And so Monday morning, Linda got me into my regular doctor, and she was upset with the other doctor, too. Anyway, then they put on 60 milligram of prednisone a day. 60 milligram of prednisone a day can make you feel like everything inside of you is turning to jello, and your heart's ready to burst into a million pieces. And so I found myself praying, please don't let me have a heart attack. And then it makes you hungry. And so every night I paced from the bedroom to the kitchen, back to the bedroom, back to the kitchen, because I was hungry all the time. And I ate a lot of Jell-O. Figured that wasn't fattening. Anyway, I'm off the road 3 more weeks because I'm in shape. In fact, the first week, Linda had to take off from work. She claimed that I was delusional, and I wanted to know how she knew that. I thought I was always delusional. But anyway. She took off work because I guess I was a mess. But anyway, I got back on the road the 1st of October and I was so thrilled to be back out there. I was weak as a kitten. I'd go to the restroom and I'd think I'm going to pass out. Lord, don't let me pass out in the restroom. And you know, last place I want to pass out. But it was rough. They put a chair up and I'd have to sit down and we had a revival to do in West Virginia, and I told Stephen, I said, I'll sing with you, and then if necessary, I'll pass out on the front seat. And it was rough. But on the other hand, I thought it over a good bit. At one point, they thought I was going to lose the eye altogether, and they said it was going to be really painful because it was shrinking. And if it continued to shrink, the pain would be excruciating, and I would be begging to have the eye taken out because the pressure had went up to the 40s. Twice this year, ready to stroke out this last year. And then it dropped down to like 4 and 5, which was way too low. So I was in danger of losing the eye. I said, well, I looked at him and I said, well, you know what? I said, I was married 28 years to a preacher and he only had one eye. He had lost an eye in a welding accident. I said, it's livable, it's doable, move on. I'm not believing for that, but move on anyhow. And I told Stephen, I said, you know, I married your papa in 1972, and he passed away in 2000. And I said, you know what? God looked down the road to 2016 and knew I'd walk the same path. I've already been there, done that. Move on. And so we did. And the other conclusion I've come to, and I thank God that I didn't lose the eye, even though I can't see anything much of anything out of it, it still hasn't, you know, come back where I have, I'm legally blind in that eye now. But I decided that if my going to Peru, because everybody said, I bet you wish you hadn't gone there. No, I'm not going to say that. Because there were people came to know Jesus Christ. Amen. And if I had to lose an eye over getting somebody to heaven, what's an eye? The Lord Jesus gave his life so I could go to heaven. And it's been an interesting year in the sense that I felt God with me every step of the way. And the thing that hurt me the worst, I think, was I got to a point where I'm thinking, I'm done. I'm not going to get to do this anymore. I'm done. And I lay in the bed and cried because I thought, I don't want to quit now. I don't want not to be able to do anymore. I want to do more for the Lord. And I'm still out here. And if the devil thought he'd stop me, he got the wrong eye. Because this one wasn't much good to start with. Anyhow, this song has been real precious to me. We're going to do a new one on you. We'll have to practice on you. It's called Just Be Held. The other night we were singing it, and I didn't have a real good day. dad growing up. Daddy finally, after mother died, I think dad finally figured out what a relationship with Jesus Christ was really supposed to be. My sister, when she was born, I'm 4 years older than her, and Daddy told me, because I always sat on Daddy's lap up till then, you know, and he'd look at pictures with me, and you know how you do with little ones. But as soon as Ruthie came, why, Daddy said I was too big to be held anymore. And I remember how badly that hurt me. And going to see, Mother took us to St. Louis to see her mother, and one of her friends, this family had two about teenage girls. And when Daddy came in, both of them were allowed to sit on Daddy's lap. And I can remember standing hid behind a drape watching this and hurting so badly inside. It took me a while to really appreciate a heavenly father, because I related that to an earthly father. And my earthly father just looked for an excuse to be able to hit me. So I'm thinking, okay, God's sitting up there just waiting on me to mess up so he can crack me over the head. Well, God isn't. God isn't out to get us, he's out to bless us. I found a heavenly father that I never get too big, I never get too old to sit on his lap. And sometimes I just need to be held. I don't need to say anything, I just need to be held. And God knows when those times are, and I'm glad we can crawl up on our Heavenly Father's lap and be held. Aren't you?
Amen.
Amen.
Okay, Stephen.
Yes.
Let's do Dear Jesus that I now know, and then you're going to get up and preach. After he's gone, I think we're supposed to let him do something else. Anyhow, but you sing, and then you preach.
I'm going to have to tell them the story about that, since you made that crack. She now knows the title of it. She used to not know the title of it. So we were at a church once and we were doing good. We knew what songs we were going to be playing. And then she just looks at me and says, "You'll play that song about Jesus." I looked at her and said, "Which one?" "Oh, the one that we do. All of our songs are about Jesus."
Oh, wow.
So now she knows the title, so I can't do that to her no more. But it doesn't prevent me from telling on her.
Well, we have a good time. Unfortunately, he's turned an awful lot like me, and he's just as quick on the uptake as I am, so I can't get ahead of it. Of course, he can't get ahead of me either. Well, he may start. I'm getting older, and he's still young. It's okay. Dear G, I love this song, though, because it's a love song to the Lord, I think. Jesus.
Anyway, If you go to joyceigoministries.com, you can find a page on Stephen as well. But I'd like to invite him up and come and share God's word this morning. And he's got a new haircut since that picture.
Well, I got the same one. It's just I've been lazy.
I like it like it is.
Mm-hmm. I know, I don't.
I know.
I like it short.
But you didn't have to wear a suit tonight, so.
Thank you. yeah, I like mine. Whenever I go to the barber, I go put it on the number 2 blade and just take it all off. Yeah, so thanks for having me. And wow, that just got really loud. Okay. If you got your Bibles, I'm just going to go to John real quick, chapter 17. And we're going to be talking a little bit about the interesting title here, When Worlds Collide. And I'm not talking about the movie or the book. But right real quick in John chapter 17. Can't figure out what.
I'm pushing everything up my Bible.
All right, and I'll just read this real quick. John chapter 17, verses 14. Jesus speaking here, I have given them your word, and the world has hated them because they are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. I don't pray that you will take them out of the world, but that you would keep them from evil. They are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. Sanctify them by truth. Your word is truth. So, Father, I thank you this morning. I thank you for the ability to sing and minister to your people. I thank you for the ability to speak. So, Father, right now, in Jesus' name, I get out of the way. I can't do this on my own, but your word tells me that through you I can do all things. So, Father, I just give myself up as an offering to you, Lord. Speak through me and minister to these your people. And it's in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, I'm going to talk real quick about when worlds collide, because as Jesus pointed out here, this was when he was praying in the Garden of Gethsemane before he was going to be crucified. And as he pointed out, he wasn't praying that the Lord take his disciples out of the world, but that he would help them while they were in the world. And I was at a VBS a while back, because some was when worlds collide. What happens? What are the different types of Christians when the world pushes? What are the reactions that people have when the world pushes us Christians? And the first one that came up was a cave-in. These people, when the world pushes, they just collapse. They just give in so easily that it's almost as if they're being afraid of being seen as a Christian. So whatever the world wants or whatever they say, they just go right along with it. I saw this very much in high school, and it made me mad to no end. Because, you know, we're supposed to be different. And I would see how whenever, like, during a FCA thing, I don't know if y'all have them up here, like it's a Christian school group kind of thing, a club. They would act one way during their meetings, and as soon as the lunch bell rang, my goodness, I didn't even recognize them anymore. But they're just like, whenever I was a kid and I had my tonsils taken out, I don't know why I remember this, but I do. Yeah, I had them weird cardboard bricks that you could build all kinds of weird walls with. They looked nice, but they were just like that because it looked great. They looked wonderful, but as soon as my mom just bumped into it somehow, all my beautiful wall just came crashing down. My castle just was destroyed in a matter of seconds. And that's exactly what these guys are. They bring themselves up and say, yes, I'm a Christian. Yes, I'm a Christian this, I'm a Christian that. And then somebody says, hey, man, you know, you ought to come join me at a party. Yeah, I know some people, and they just give in. They do not want conflict, so they just give in. And it's like, oh, what could it hurt? And so they just go right along with them. And they're just like chameleons, blending in with any situation that they are opposed with. For example, Sunday morning, they could be the loudest, most wonderful person, praising the Lord, this, that, and the other. But on Monday, they could be in a bar, they could be somewhere else, or they could just be at home watching who knows what. They just blend in with whatever environment they're in. And the reason why so many Christians do not have a positive impact on the world today is because the world, they are siding with Satan by doing whatever the world wants. And this is like Peter, unfortunately. I'm going to pick on Peter a little bit. Whenever Jesus was on trial, Peter was at the fire around there. And people were like, oh, I know you. You're with him. I've seen you. And he just, nope, I don't know. I don't know him. Never seen him before in my life. I don't even, what's his name? Jesus or something? I've never heard of him. Well, eventually somebody just came up and said, no, your speech betrays you. I know you're with him. You talk just like him. This Bible says he cursed and said, I don't know this man. He changed the way he presented himself to blend in. And that's exactly what these cave-ins do. The next person is the cave dweller. These are very interesting people because they understand that the world has a bad influence on them. They understand that. But they go the extra mile. They stay in their own little Christian bubble and refuse to come out. In a world of subculture of Christianity where we have Christian books, Christian TV, Christian shirts, Christian this, Christian that, they refuse to go outside into the world and just stay in their own little bubble and refuse to come out. They don't want conflict, so they never go out to see it. They never leave to go out into the world. However, the problem here is that God called us to be an impact on the world, to go out and make disciples, to go out and preach the gospel, not sit there and cower from the world. Jesus wants us to influence the world, not cower from it. And you know, by them caving in their own little system here, they are complete and utterly disregarding the commandment that Jesus gave, where he said, go out and teach the gospel, make disciples. Freely you have been given, freely give to. And we can see this with Jonah because he had his own little bubble there. He was that own little prophet in his town. And God said, you know what, go to Nineveh. That sounds like a good idea. Go to Nineveh, preach there. And he just went the other direction and then ended up getting swallowed by a whale. So the problem here is that people so many times, especially these people, they're like, yes, Lord, I'll serve you, Lord. Just don't send me there. Don't make me do that. Don't touch this. That's mine. So they give God everything, but as soon as he reaches out to receive from them, they take it back. What do these two people have in common here? I'm just going to brief overview some here. Well, they both seek to avoid messy conflicts. They both do not want conflicts. They both don't want to get in an argument. They don't want to be called out necessarily. But they both may love God and have good intentions, but the way they go about their Christian walk is completely wrong. The problem here is that Jesus doesn't tell us to blend in invisibly in the world. He doesn't tell us to hide from it. He tells us to go out and be a difference. Be a follower, not just a fan of Jesus. I've heard, there's a book I read a long time ago called Not a Fan, and it talks about how a fan, like say for example a football team, a fan of a football team will shout and yay, yes, go, get the, I don't watch sports, so I'm kind of blank here. But as soon as the team does bad, they're nowhere to be found. As soon as there's a hard streak and they're not winning as often as they used to, they're nowhere to be found. However, a dedicated follower, even during a hard streak, they are in there, their faces are painted, and they're going all crazy. We are supposed to be followers of Christ. Not just following, going after him when things are good or when things are going great, but even during the hard times as Job, where he says, though he kill me, yet will I trust in him. Though he slay me, I will still look and I will see him in the flesh. Though my mama loses an eye, she won't, but though she had all that infection, it still goes to say, I will still follow him. And that leads us to the third person here, the collider. This, I've done depressed you with the cave-ins and the cave dwellers. This is a positive thing. This person is like the firefighter and the policeman of today, where everybody's running in the opposite direction. These people are heading right into it to take sin's destructive force head on. These people are simply people who want to honor God more so than please people. These ones are the guys that will stand up for what's right, even when they're being made fun of, mocked at, and even bullied, because they believe in Jesus Christ and they want to do what he says. This was a very rare thing in my high school. As I pointed out, a lot of people were either the cave-ins or the cave dwellers. But there were a few people I saw that did want to be true believers of Christ. They wanted to stand up for what was right. And they didn't care what the cost was. They didn't care if they were ostracized from everybody else. They wanted to please God. And these people, in a society that says, oh, it's all about us. It's all about what makes us feel good. Go out and be happy and be merry, for tomorrow we die, or whatever. These people know that it's all about Jesus. These people know that there is a life after this one, and what we do here determines where we'll spend it. These colliders, they act in a way that transformed the world around them by pointing to God. In fact, people will be drawn to this person because they will see that something is different about them. They will see that, yeah, okay, the world is crumbling around them, and yet they still have that stupid smile on their face. What's going on here? I don't get this. It's like Job. The world was crumbling around him, and yet he still had an ability to praise God. Still had an ability to look up and say, though my flesh be destroyed, yet in the flesh I will see him. I will see my deliverer. Some people here that we were colliders was David. I wasn't reading it, I'm not going to lie, I was driving, but I was listening to it on my iPod, where David went up against Goliath. A youth kid, probably like 11, 12 years old, went up against a man of war when everybody was cowering away from him. He decided that it was worth defending God's honor, even if it killed him. Another one was Josiah, an 8-year-old kid, when he became the king of Israel. He found the word of God and said, you know what, we're going to go back to that. We're going to go back to the old ways. And was able to turn an entire nation around in his reign. Another one was Timothy, the young preacher in the New Testament church, who, despite being young, was a head pastor of a church and helping point the way to Jesus. The next one is a question. Where do we fall into these categories? Are we the cave-in who, as soon as conflict comes, as soon as somebody says, oh, that's kind of lame, don't you think? Do we just cave in and say, yeah, you know what, you're right, let's just do something? Are we the cave dwellers who are so insulated in our Christian bubble that we refuse to go outside and point to the world of Jesus? Or are we the collider who will actually be in the world, but not of the world? Someone who actually goes out and tries to take on sins head on just to see Jesus save one. You know, as I've been pointing out a lot, I've seen a lot of these in my high school. But there's one other person in this category here. One other person that just cannot be forgotten about. And that's the non-Christian. The person who's actually watching us to see where we stand. You see, non-Christian people, the unsaved people, sometimes we're the only Bible they'll ever read. And based on what you show will determine how their view of Christianity is. For the cave-in, I can just hear them now, well, why do I need to be saved? They act just like me. And if their faith is so important to them, why do they try so hard to be like us? If they love this Jesus so much and say, oh yeah, he's real awesome, the Bible says this, that, and the other, then why do they act like me? Somebody who's supposedly not saved. If they're going to heaven, I most certainly am. On the cave dweller, they see somebody so insulated, and this is in fact where the saying goes, well, if you're a Christian, you can't have no fun no more. That's because these cave dwellers, they insulate themselves so heavily that it's like they refuse to go out and show that being a Christian is actually enjoyable. It's not just something you just sit there, clap your hands, and say kumbaya. In fact, I've had more fun as a Christian than I ever would a sinner. And then finally, the collider. When they see the collider, they actually see, as I pointed out earlier, something different. There's something different about them. They have this look on them where even if the world is crashing, they're still fine. They're still able to have that smile on their face. They're still able to have joy, unspeakable and full of glory. Why? And they'll be drawn to that. In high school, I did not fit into any of the cliques. I was with the nobodies. We were even lower than the band geeks. But because I had Jesus, they actually, for some strange reason, were drawn to me. They came to me looking for advice. They would ask, what do you think of this? What would the Bible say about this? What do you think? And eventually, I had four carloads of kids coming to my youth group. Not because of anything I did, just because I was not willing to bend my knee to anything other than Jesus. Just because I would not sit there and soil the name of God. Even though my own father made fun of me because I wanted to be a preacher, I didn't give up. I didn't bend my knee. Because I knew something was better than what this world had to offer. And so to end, I just want to, fitting with the New Year theme, don't just think about this right now, but think about this all year round. Where are you fitting into this? Are you the cave-in, the collider, the cave dweller? Or are you even the non-Christian? And if you are or know somebody that is, I encourage you, give your heart to Jesus. I'll tell you this much, it's not as lame as people try to say it is. It's actually quite enjoyable for me. Not just here, but later on when we go see Jesus face to face. It's even better than that. So, Father, I thank you tonight, Lord, this morning, rather, Father. And I just ask, Lord, that you minister today. If maybe there's something I said, something that was done, something that was sung, Lord, that you would minister to these your people. And be with them and bless them, Father, for coming out. And I just thank you and I praise you for them. And it's in Jesus' name. And before any of you raise up your heads, I have to ask, because this is the most important question, is there anybody here that is not saved and you wish to be saved? I just ask if you just lift up and raise and put back down your hand. Anybody who needs Jesus? All right. Now, does anybody want any kind of special prayer? Maybe you say, you know what, I'm the cave-in. I'm the cave dweller, but I want to become that collider. I want to go out there and be brave and stand up for what Jesus says. If that's you, then I encourage you, you don't have to come up if you don't want to, but lift up your hand and we will pray. And we'll pray that Jesus gives you that courage, gives you that strength, gives you his power to do so. Well, Lord, I thank you once again, and I just ask you, bless these your people. Strengthen them, Lord, to go out into the world and not be of the world, even though they're in the world. And I thank you and I praise you, Lord. And it's in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen.